Well, good morning, good morning, good morning, Facebook. Good morning, people on the conference call. Good morning, good morning. This is the day that the Lord have made, and I am rejoicing, and I'm glad in it. I'm so glad to see the dawn of another day. Amen, amen. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Welcome, 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 welcome. Amen, amen. We're gonna get started in just 1 second, probably. Amen. But in the meantime, we just want to praise God. We want to give him praise, glory, and honor. Amen. We want to welcome, welcome, welcome the Holy Spirit in our midst this morning. Welcome, Holy Spirit. You are welcome. You are welcome. We welcome. We welcome you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Glory, 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 glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on in. Come on in. Amen. Holy Spirit, just come on in and dwell within us. Holy Spirit, fall fresh on us. Holy Spirit, how you have your way this morning. Holy Spirit, oh, saturate us with your presence. Holy Spirit, just move mightily. Hallelujah. 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 Good morning, daughter and love. Amen. Our scripture this morning, we just got one scripture. One scripture coming from the gospel of the book of Matthew, chapter 5.
Thank you, Jesus.
Matthew 5. Amen. Verse 6. Matthew 5, verse 6 reads, "Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled." Again, Matthew 5, verse 6. "Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness." Amen, amen.
Amen.
And my title this morning is, "Are you hungry and thirsty for God?" Are you hungry and are you thirsty for God? Amen. There's a lot of hungering and thirsting going on in our world. In this world, there are 20,000 people that die of hunger each day. In the United States alone, approximately 4 million low-income children under the age of 12 experience hunger each day. However, almost 100 billion pounds of safe and edible foods such as meat and poultry, fruits and vegetables, milk and eggs, they are thrown away every year by retailers and restaurants and farmers, while so many Americans are hungry. And I imagine if we put our food in there too, we are guilty of throwing away food, amen, that some hungry person will be glad to have. Again, I'm talking about, are you hungry and thirsty for God? The desire for food and water are the strongest appetites we have as human beings. Therefore, it's difficult for so many Americans to lose weight because that desire for food, I'm telling you the truth, is so powerful, and it's just so difficult sometimes to not pick up, amen, that food and eat it, amen. And when I say food, the wrong type of food. You know, we don't just want any food. We want the wrong food, amen. So hunger is a powerful emotion. It controls us, and so often it determines our direction. And so when Jesus spoke these words in Matthew 5 and 6, amen, the people gathered on the hillside and in Galilee understood them much differently than most of us understand them today. You see, Jesus was preaching to people who truly knew what it was to go several days and even longer with little or nothing to eat or drink so they could relate to this text. Amen. Just think about the event when he fed, you know, 5,000 plus with just two fish, amen, and loaves of bread, amen. So, but unlike many of us today, we just casually read this text in Matthew 5 and 6. We talk about the blessed are those who hunger and thirst for God, for they shall be filled, amen, amen. Because we don't really understand hunger and thirst. They don't compute, amen, in our brain, amen. They don't compute, amen, because we have not experienced that gnawing in our stomach and the purging, the thirst. You just got to have something to drink, amen. So this morning, we're going to examine four things in this passage, amen, dealing with hunger and thirst, amen. First, we need to know what is the meaning of being hungry and thirsty in this passage. And again, because we rarely experience real hunger or thirst, we sometimes miss the urgencies of these words. Jesus was describing a person who was at a point of just starving to death if they did not get something to eat, or a person who was dehydrated that they would just die if they don't get something to drink. But what we need to understand is that a starving person has a single, all-consuming passion, and it's for food and water. Because a man who's starving to death does not want something to eat and a new suit. The woman who is dehydrated to the point of death does not want a drink of water and a new car. Their desperation makes them very single-minded just for food and water alone. Nothing else has the slightest attraction or appeal. Nothing else can even get their attention. Not money, not job, not a house, not a car. Nothing but satisfying their hunger and the thirst for food and water. I just finished reading a book about one of the ladies that's on the prayer line that I'm on Monday through Friday. And this lady, she grew up in New York. And she wrote a book detailing her life growing up in New York with a mother who had mental illness and who often left her and her two sisters for weeks at a time alone in an apartment with no food or nothing to drink in the house. And while she was about six and her sisters were about five and four, I might have got the age wrong, but they were still kids. On one occasion, all that she could find in the house when her mother was just out there, just wandering the street talking to herself, were a couple slices of bread and a little sugar, probably just a pack of sugar, which she mixed with water. And they all shared, all three of the children, shared their sugar sandwich. And she said many days they went without food and something to drink. And on one occasion, their mother took them out on an outing, and where they seemed to walk about an hour, and they ended up at this trash dumpster. And then her mother picked her up, granted she's like five or six, picked her up, leaned her over into this dirty and stinking dumpster for her to look for food and something to drink. However, she had to do what she needed to survive. And so she got past the smell. She got past, you know, the stench in that dumpster. And she just scrounged around until she found some half-eaten sandwiches or some food. And then she found some cups with some drinks or water people had thrown away. And then she and her sisters were just so happy to get anything to eliminate the hunger and the thirst pains. Amen. They got beyond the smell. They got beyond the taste. Amen. All they wanted was something to eat because they had not had anything to eat or drink for, I said, weeks and stuff on end. So, saints, make no mistake. Only Jesus It's the answer to our hunger and our thirst pains. Saints, to be truly hungry and thirsty for God in our text is defined as to make our relationship with Him our highest priority and purpose in life. And so Jesus is saying, blessed are those who are craving for the things of God, and just as tense as they crave for food and water. Amen. Second, we find in our text, we find the object, amen, of our spiritual hunger and our spiritual thirst. Do you realize sometimes that hunger is a good thing? It's not good that people are hungry, amen, but it's a good thing to get hungry. You see, a lack of appetite is always a signal that something is wrong with us in our bodies. Because healthy people, they get hungry because the body needs fuel to function, amen. And so God created the hunger trigger in our bodies so that we would be motivated to fuel it up so that we would not starve to death. You know, sometimes, you know, older people sometimes when they get dementia or Alzheimer, that trigger's gone. They forget that they are hungry. They forget that they need something to eat. And that's why sometimes people with Alzheimer or dementia will die of that disease. Amen. Because I wondered one time, I'm like, how, you know, Alzheimer and dementia is a mind thing. How can people die of that disease? And then I had to learn, yes, they die of the disease because they forget to eat. They forget that they need to eat. Amen. They never get hungry. Amen. And sometimes they just forget how to eat. Amen. So God also created us not only to hunger and thirst for food and drink, but to hunger and to thirst for Him, to have a relationship with Him. You see, human beings, we yearn to know God. Believe it or not, a person does not have to be a Christian to hunger and thirst for God. God created us to know Him, to love Him, to serve Him. But when sin entered the creation, this hunger and this thirst for God and good was redirected toward other gods, towards junk foods, amen, that can really never satisfy our spirit, amen. So again, hunger, thirst for positions and power and prestige and pleasure or praise, amen. Some people hunger for those things. And the reason those things never truly satisfy is that they can't. God has created man with a thirst and a hunger for Him that nothing else can satisfy. But instead of turning to God, people try to find satisfaction in all the wrong places and in all the wrong things. Amen.
Amen.
When the prodigal son left home, he expected to find satisfaction and pleasure in the world. He realized he didn't think he could find those things in his father's house, amen. He wanted clothes. He wanted money. He wanted companionship. He wanted that fast life, amen. But instead of those things, he ended up finding poverty and hunger, loneliness, and misery in the world. You see, when he was hungry and his money was gone, he turned to feeding the swine. It was only when he was finally starving that he turned back to his father. Amen. And because in his father's house, he remembered what he thought he didn't have, he had all the time. When he was at home with his father, he didn't lack clothes to wear. He didn't lack food to eat. Amen. And so when he went back home, his father gladly welcomed him back. Amen. That's the same thing our Heavenly Father does for us. He recognized where He created us. We can go into this world and we can have all these fine things in life. But those fine things in life can never satisfy what God has put into us is a relationship with Him. Amen. Yes, we consume vast amounts of cheap, fat-filled, sugary, calorie-laden foods that do not really satisfy our hunger, which only cause us to eat much more than we need to consume. As a result, our lives are full, yet our souls are starved. Yes, we may be physically fat, but many people are spiritually malnourished. They're on the very edge of starvation. Because our hunger for God must be greater than our hunger for the things of this world. Jesus says in our text that the object of our spiritual hunger and our thirst should be righteousness. In fact, Jesus said that with the same intensity that a man who's about to die from lack of food, amen, or who's dying from dehydration because of lack of water, amen, we should have that same intense hunger and thirst for righteousness, amen. So what is righteousness? To put it simply, it's being right with God. Having a right relationship with God. Amen. You know, some people may have a relationship with God, but they don't have a right relationship with God. Righteousness is having that right relationship with God. And Jesus said that the blessed life is the life that is right with Him. And we can only be right with God if we have a relationship with His Son, Jesus Christ. And when we have a relationship with Jesus, we try to have the mind of Christ and do what Christ would do. Also, when we have that relationship with Jesus, we will drink that living water that Christ offers us to drink, amen. We will put aside those sodas, amen, that Kool-Aid, amen, that alcohol, amen, and pick up and quench our thirst on that living water that only comes from Jesus Christ. Saints, we can buy all kinds of Bibles and we'll end up being thirsty. We can buy Christian stickers and t-shirts, go to Christian bookstores, and we still could be thirsty. We can attend service after service on Facebook or Zoom to water our lives, and we can still be thirsty. All because we don't drink from the well that never runs dry. All because we have not partaken of the living water. Only when we partake of the living water and eat from the bread of life, which is Jesus Christ, amen, can our souls be satisfied, amen. Why, saints, why do we allow our souls to be shriveled and dehydrated? You see, thirst, again, is one of the most powerful spiritual symbols in our scripture. As dehydration draws the hold of our physical being to a longing for water, so a spiritual void should draw our spirits into a search for a deeper meaning to our lives. You see, before we can really have a close relationship with God, we have to thirst for God. We would never have a close relationship with God until we thirst and hunger after God. This is why Jesus says, if anyone is thirsty, let him come to me and drink, amen. He recognized, amen, that the water of this world, the alcohol of this world, the sodas of this world cannot quench our spiritual thirst, amen. You know, sometimes, you know, I have a taste for a soda, amen. I don't drink soda too much these days and stuff. But sometimes I have that craving for a soda, amen. And when I drink that soda, amen, I still feel thirsty, amen. So I have to grab H2O water, amen, and drink. And that water, amen, is the only thing will that satisfy my thirst. And that's the same thing that Jesus telling us about spiritual water, amen. We can be drinking from other wells and other sources, amen. But until we drink from that spiritual fountain, amen, our soul will still be thirsty. Until we eat God's spiritual food, our souls and our stomachs and our bellies will still feel empty, amen. Amen. Again, what does Jesus mean when he says hunger and thirst for righteousness? This righteousness is not about stuff. It's not about doing things, amen. This righteousness is about being, again, right with God. It's about having a relationship, a personal, a intimate relationship with God. Amen. To be very clear, hungering and thirsting for righteousness isn't about doing religious things. It's about hungering for a relationship with God. Yes, we can go to church again. We can join all these ministries, amen. And we can sing and do all these things. We can even preach the gospel. But if we don't have that right relationship with God, it's still in vain. We'll still feel empty on the inside. That's why sometimes you feel that your prayer is not going any further than out of your mouth. Amen. That's why sometimes we feel that God is far away from us. Amen. Because we are hungering and thirsty for the living God, and we're not feasting on God. We're not feasting on his word. We're not feasting on spending time with God. Amen. Only those things, amen, can contribute to our soul being satisfied and full. Amen. And so to grow in our relationship with the Lord is what God desires of us. Amen. We need to allow the Lord to be more than our Savior. But we have to learn to let the Lord be our Lord. Well, we can trust that he's still in charge, even during a pandemic, even when we have COVID-19, even when we experience homelessness, joblessness, friendlessness, amen. Because when Christ is our Lord, more than our Savior, amen. Some people accept him as Savior, but they have not made him Lord, amen. So when we make the Jesus Lord, we will begin to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, amen. When we make him Lord, amen, more than just our Savior. Yes, we need him as a Savior, but we need him also to be our Lord, amen, to take control of our lives, amen. Saints, just as you and I develop appreciation for foods that are good for us and not necessarily taste good to us, prayerfully, we will, over time, develop an increasing desire for the things of God as we allow the Spirit to lead us. For the illustration, when I was growing up as a child, I hated salads. I didn't like green salad. I didn't like turnip salads. I didn't like cabbage too much. I didn't like those vegetables, amen. If you offered me vegetables, amen, amen, a vegetable back then, I would just turn up my nose at it and say, I don't want that, amen. But I've learned, saints, nowadays I welcome, amen, for a good salad, amen. I welcome it, amen. Now I love, amen, a well-made salad, amen. But I had to develop an appetite for that salad, amen. So we have to develop an appetite for God, amen. We have to develop an appetite and a thirst for righteousness, amen. So my point is, I eat in a way that is much healthier than I did growing up, amen. Because I'm willing to venture beyond cheeseburger and macaroni and cheese to train my palate to appreciate more complex kinds of food. Amen. Now, amen, you have to do the same thing in your walk with the Lord. You have to choose, amen, to have a healthy, amen, relationship with the Lord. Amen. Now, and when we do that, amen, yes, yes, there will be more Bible reading, more prayers, but as a means of communicating with the one we love, amen, not out of a religious duty. I can preach to you all day. Oh, you need to read your Bible. You need to pray, amen. But until you develop a personal appetite for those things, amen, you will not do them, amen. You will not do them. And when you do them, you're just doing it out of duty obligation. You don't have that desire, amen, to continue on when nobody's looking. You don't have that desire to pick it up in your home, amen. Only time you pick it up is when you go to church or when you're looking at a service. When you have that hunger and you have that appetite for God, for righteousness, amen, you cannot get enough of God's word. You cannot get enough but communing with the Lord. Nobody has to push you or make you do anything. It is what you do because you know you need that for to grow with the Lord. Amen. So when Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, he uses words which means that it's an unqualified and an unlimited hunger and thirst that he put within us. So when you get saved, you do not stop hungering and thirsting for righteousness. When we came to Christ, we hungered and thirst for righteousness. And now that we know him more, we continue to hunger and thirst for more of him. Third, in this passage, we need to identify the test of a spiritual hunger and thirst. How can you tell if you are truly hungering and thirsting after righteousness? Let me suggest three questions that might act as a test of your spiritual hunger and your spiritual thirst. First test is, are you satisfied with yourself? Are you satisfied with your life? Are you satisfied with your relationship with the Lord? Do you feel a constant pain of falling short? That is a symbol of one who is seeking God's way. We are not truly hungering and thirsting for righteousness as long as we are holding on to any sense that we ourselves are good enough to stand in God's presence. As long as we believe it's because of who we are and what we have done and what we have that we will see God, we are not hungering. We're not hungering for God. We're not thirsty for God. We're just satisfied with the status quo, amen. You feel, I'm good enough, amen. But saints, we can never be good enough, no matter how long you've been with the Lord, no matter how great you are a Christian. We should still maintain that daily hunger, that daily thirst for Christ. You know, every day we get up, we're looking for what I'm going to eat today, what I'm going to drink today. We should be the same way about our relationship with the Lord. Every day we get up, we need to look to satisfy that spiritual hunger, that spiritual thirst. The second test you need to ask, are you willing to deal with hindrances in your life? You may say, well, I believe in Jesus with all my heart, but I'm afraid that I do not have a great desire to continue to grow spiritually. Have you ever stopped to consider how things have had an influence on how you feel? It may be that you are filling your life with so many other things, so many other activities that you no longer sense your hunger for God. Amen. Because we load up on everything the world has to offer, we have quenched our appetite for the things that really matter. So, because if we are truly hungering and thirsting after righteousness, we will not only avoid those things that are bad and harmful, but even those things that are dull, that take the edge off our spiritual appetite. You see, a hunger and a thirst for righteousness will not be satisfied with anything else. And the third test that you might do, ask yourself, are you willing to put yourself in the pathway of attaining righteousness. Hear me. The person who is really hungering and thirsting for righteousness will never miss the opportunity to be in places where people find righteousness. The person who is seeking righteousness is not haphazard about their attendance and worship and doing Bible study. They're not haphazard about attending women conferences and men conferences, amen, or seminars. The person who is serious and seeking righteousness seeks godly company rather than just hanging around with worldly individuals. The person who is seeking righteousness spends quality time with the Lord and seek his presence more than seeking his hand. Sometimes people, all they come to the Lord is for to ask God, gimme, 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 gimme. They never seek God just to be in his presence, to minister to God. People don't seek God out just to praise his name, just to give him thanks, just to worship in his presence, amen. They only come, amen, when they need something, when there's a crisis, amen. When they're asking God, when they're seeking his hands. But God said, come and seek my face, amen. Because he said, in my presence, there's fullness of joy, amen. You can't find joy in things. You find joy in the presence of the Lord, amen, amen. So, again, the person who is serious about righteousness affords themselves opportunity, amen, to read God's word and to pray, amen. They don't let distractions, amen, distract them, amen. They get focused, amen. They consistent and insistent that they're going to read, they're going to pray, they're going to study, they're going to fellowship, they're going to minister to the Lord. An illustration of how do you know if you're filled with righteousness? Well, think for a moment about a sponge that's soaked with water. If you push down with your finger, just like that, you don't have to just mash it down. If that sponge is full of water and you press down just ever so lightly, guess what? You'll see water running out of that sponge. We immediately know what fills the interior pocket of the sponge. What the saying should be true of us. We can tell what fills us on the inside by what comes out of us under pressure. Oops! What comes out of you under pressure? Is it righteous words or holy language? Is it moaning and complaining or rejoicing? What comes out of you, amen, with somebody that's push your button, amen? That will tell you whether you filled with righteousness or not, amen? And so the last thing we find in our text is, what is the result of spiritual hunger? Amen. The result is that God promised us that we'll be satisfied. You see, our part is to seek righteousness. God's part is to satisfy us with righteousness. The psalmist said in 107, verse 9, for he satisfies the longing soul, and he fills the hungry soul with goodness. But there's a paradox within this promise of satisfaction. The paradox is you are satisfied, but guess what? You are never truly satisfied. On the other hand, the Lord wants us to maintain a hunger and thirst. But on the other hand, we are promised satisfaction. How can this be? We see the paradox of this satisfaction in salvation. When we are saved, the hunger for a relationship with God is immediately and completely satisfied. We receive the satisfaction of salvation, but then there should develop within our soul a desire for more and more and more of God. We have God, but we should desire more of God. And in satisfaction, we're never satisfied because we desire more and more of God. We can see the reality of this physical realm when we eat our favorite dessert. After eating it, we are satisfied. But that wonderful taste, it creates a hunger of what we have already tasted. Amen. It's just like that commercial. You cannot eat one Lay's potato chip. Amen. And be satisfied. That should be like God. We cannot just get one experience of God and be satisfied. Yes, we experience salvation, but we should want more and more of God. Amen. Because the more we taste spiritually, the greater and of our appetite and appreciation should be of God. And the more we read God's word, the more desire we should know for God's word to be stirred within us. Unfortunately, we have very little hunger for God. Be honest. We have very little hunger for God. Amen. And very little desire for his presence because of our spiritual digestive system has shut down. We are so used to junk food that we feel spiritually bloated, even though we may be experiencing malnutrition. Amen. I read about a man that they could not get out of his house because he was so obese. They had to break down the door, bring in a special lift to get him out of his own house. What caught the attention of the doctor was, after examining this man, they found that this man, even though he was obese, he was suffering from malnutrition. I thought to myself, how can that be? How can someone who weighs 800 pounds be experiencing malnutrition? You see, there's a link between malnutrition and obesity. Sometimes our body is not getting what it needs, even though we're eating. We can stuff ourselves with popcorn, Doritos, pizzas, sodas, all kinds of snacks, ice cream, amen, that have zero nutritional value. And then we end up, I'm talking about myself too, Saints, we end up getting big, heavy, and look like we're well fed. People say, well, you look like you haven't missed a meal. Well, we might not have missed a meal, amen, but we'll miss the nutritious meal, amen, because we are malnourished. So are you experiencing obesity in your Christianity and malnutrition at the same time? There is more available in our society than ever before, amen. There are still too many Christians still drinking milk as an adult because they have never moved to meat and they are malnourished. There are too many Christians who have never attained an appetite for the word. They are just content to listening to the gospel music. They are malnourished because as soon as the music stops, guess what? They fall asleep. If they don't fall asleep, they start getting up, going to the bathroom, going to get a drink of water, amen. They're not that interested in hearing the word of God, amen. All they want to do is hear the music. They want to be ministered to the flesh, but they don't want the spirit to be ministered and fed to. And as a result, amen, people are malnourished in their walk and their faith, and they are not hungering and thirsting for a living relationship with the Lord. I think it's interesting that Jesus used the metaphor of hungering and thirsting, because not only are these powerful and intrinsic desires for humanity, but the satisfaction of those appetites is a very pleasant thing. You see, eating and drinking are pleasurable. I'm telling the truth. Eating and drinking are pleasurable. Amen. But we have to be eating the right thing. We have to be drinking the right thing, amen. Oh, that we will hunger and thirst for God as much as we do for the natural food and the natural drinks. Oh, that we will hunger and thirst, amen, amen, for the things of this of the spiritual things more than the things of this world. We should hunger for God more than anything or anyone, because He alone can satisfy, can fulfill, can develop, heal, save, transform, equip our lives. Nothing else comes close to a relationship with God. Yet every day, people, even people in the church, substitute things and persons for God's special place in their hearts. They look for satisfaction in drugs. They look for satisfaction in alcohol. They look for satisfaction in sex. They look for satisfaction in acquiring a job. They look for satisfaction in being married. They look for satisfaction in having children. But lasting satisfaction only comes by staying hungry and thirsting for the Lord, by cultivating a relationship with Him every day. If there is one thing God wants of us during these days, that one thing is a relationship. I sincerely believe God wants to renew our relationship with Him. For some, the first step of that relationship is beginning to have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen. We live in a time when thousands of people are religious. Hear me now. They are religious, but not in a relationship with God. Batman's foe, Two-Face, is characteristic of so many people's lives, where one reality exists only on Sunday, and quite another reality exists for them Monday through Saturday. Amen. Yes, they come in and they sing hallelujah, glory to God on Sunday, but on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, amen, there's no hallelujah, there's no praise the Lord, there's no God is good, there's no mention of God Monday through Saturday. But on Sunday morning, amen, they're passing out, they're shouting, amen, they're ripping and running, amen, amen. But where is the reality Monday through Saturday? God is the same God every day of the week, amen. Every day of the week, we need to be praising God, amen. We need to be lifting up God's name. We need to be a witness to the truth about God. We need to be telling somebody that God is good, amen. Amen. Let me be blunt. Most of us are about as close to God as we want to be. We have as much joy as we want. We have much peace as we want. For the most part, we are where we are right now because that's where we want to be. Because if we were hungry and thirsty for something better from God, we could have it. Saints,
that's right.
If you want it, you could have a closer walk with God. If you want it, you could grow spiritually. If you want it, you can become a man and a woman of God. If you want to, you can change some of those deep ingrained habits. If you want to, you can memorize scripture. If you want to, you can learn how to pray. The question is, how much do you want to do those things? How much, amen, do you want to grow in your walk with God? How much, amen, do you want to be that child of God, amen, who's always filled with joy, always have peace, always, amen, no matter what life serves them? When life serves them lemon, they learn how to turn it to lemonade, amen, because they want to have joy. They want to be at peace with God. They want to be in a loving relationship with the Lord. People do what they want to do. People go where they want to go. People buy what they want to buy. Amen. So if you want it bad enough, you can have that relationship with the Lord. Amen. Amen. Because our relationship with God should be our number one focus. We should know that if we take care of God, everything else will be taken care of. My prayer is that God will do such a work in us as believers that we will never lose our appetite for Him. We will know that we need God to survive. We will know that we are nothing, have nothing, and can do nothing without God. Because when we hunger and thirst for God, we can say that God is my everything. He's my joy and sorrow. He's my hope for tomorrow. He's my rock in a weary land. He's my shelter in a time of storm. He's my friend when I'm lonely. He's my medicine when I'm sick. He's my bread of life when I'm hungry. He's my living water when I'm thirsty. My God is my everything. Amen. And let me tell you this. You say, I'm satisfied with God. But King God says he is satisfied with your relationship with him. Amen. And let me close with this final thing. Without God, our week would be like this. It would be Sunday, Morn Day, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Fight Day, Shadow Day. Because 7 days without God will make us weak. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. And may you hunger and thirst for the living God. Amen. Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be filled. They shall be satisfied. Amen. And when you hunger and thirst for righteousness, you're saying that you're hungering and thirsting for that relationship with God. Amen. A right relationship with God. You say in your heart, I want to be right. I want to be right. I want to be right with God. Amen. And when you're right with God, he has a way of making you right with man. Amen. And even if man don't appreciate you, it's better to be right with God than to be right with man. Amen. Because God needs to be our priority. Amen. God is what we need. Amen. To satisfy our thirst and our hunger. Amen. So during this pandemic, amen, you may say you might want a cure for it. You might want people to do this and that. Your desire during this pandemic is to have a right relationship with God. Because if you're right with God, amen, you don't have to worry about this pandemic. You don't have to worry about how long. But you know that God has you, amen. He has you. He has you, amen. Amen. So don't focus on this pandemic, amen. Don't focus on a bottle. Don't focus on pills, amen. I'm not saying sometimes you don't need medicine. But focus instead on the Lord. Know what God can do for you. God can satisfy your deepest longing. God can meet needs in your life that nobody, nothing else can meet. Amen. God needs to be your everything. If I could sing, I would sing that song for you. God is my everything. Amen. He is my everything. Amen. Amen. God bless you again. Amen. It's time for prayer. It's time for us to go into prayer.
Thank you, Jesus.
Amen. I do remember we're going to pray for the Riley Keys family. We're going to pray for the Mitchell Clark family. We're going to lift up Margie Talley, Bishop Peace, Charlene Hightower, Shirley Merle, Jenny Wilson, Malik Davis, B.J. Bailey, Dally Dixon, Ford family. We're going to lift up those things. If there are other things, amen, amen, amen. Anthony Sumner, amen. Amen. But I'm going to lift up us that we acquire that taste for the Lord. That we acquire, amen, a taste for him. Some people believe that God is so dull and boring. But we have to, you know, it's tasteless. Amen. Scripture said, but taste and see that he's good. Some people have not tasted to see he is good. They're just going through the motion. Yes, they might be Christians.
That's right.
But they have not cultivated a relationship or taste for the Lord. They have not cultivated that. Amen. 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 So let's go to the Lord in prayer.
Thank you.
Holy Spirit, once again, we ask you to fall on us. Holy Spirit, stir up that hunger. Stir up a thirst for righteousness, for the things of God. And even for not just the things of God, for God himself. Sometimes we want things from God, but we want that hunger and thirst for God himself. Lord God, we want God. We want Jesus. We want the Holy Spirit. We want all that you have for us, Lord God. Satisfy us, Lord God. Stir it up within us, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Put us in remembrance of our first love. Put us in remembrance of how much you love us and how much you desire us to be in fellowship with you. Stir up, Lord God, remembrance of how jealous you are as a God, Lord God. You said you don't want any other God before you, Lord God. That God could be food. That God could be alcohol. That God could be money, cars, possessions, Lord God, material things. But Lord God, we need a hunger and thirst for spiritual things, for you, God. So Lord God, whet our appetite for you right now, God, that we cannot get enough of you, Lord God, enough of your word, Lord God. That Lord God, that when we want to watch TV, Lord God, that appetite will stir in us, Lord God, that we turn off the TV, turn off the radio, Lord God, and steal away and be with you, Lord God. Lord God, we thank you for that. We pray, Lord God, for comfort for Sandra Riley and her brothers and the rest of the family, Lord God. Comfort them, Lord God, as they prepare, Lord God, to bury their mother, Lord God, on Friday, Lord God. Comfort them, Lord God. Comfort their hearts, Lord God. Yes, they know, Lord God, that their mother is in a better place and that she's not suffering any longer, Lord God. But, Lord God, there still is a void, Lord God. There's somebody missing, Lord God, that was there with them, Lord God. Lord God, that gave birth to them, Lord God. Shared food with them, Lord God. Nourished them to adulthood, Lord God. And that person is no longer there, Lord God. So we pray, Lord God, that you fill that empty void in their life, Lord God, with your peace, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, Lord God. We thank the Mitchell family, the Clark family, Lord God, the Michener family, Lord God, Cruz family, Lord God, the Plummer family, Lord God. Lift them up into you, Lord God. Every family member, Lord God. Lift them up, Lord God. Lift up the greater spiritual family, Lord God. Lift them up into you, God. Oh, Lord God, draw us closer to you, Lord God. Lord God, let our walk be so close with you, Lord God, that nothing can separate us from your love, Lord God. Lord God, we know that nothing can separate God's love from us, Lord God. But we don't want nothing to separate our love from God, Lord God. Nothing to come between our relationship with him, Lord God. So, Lord God, we pray for family members, Lord God. Some are not saved, Lord God. Some are still carnal Christians, Lord God. And some are still, Lord God, growing, God. But we pray, Lord God, that you just press upon their heart, Lord God. Now is the day of salvation. Now is the day to draw close to thee. Because you said we draw close to you, that you will draw close to us, Lord God. So we want to draw close to you. We want to have that desire, Lord God, to draw close to you, Lord God. Not just talk about a relationship, Lord God, but have that close relationship with you, Lord God. We lift up Margie Talley, Lord God, and Charlene Hightower, Lord God, who's suffering with COVID-19, Lord God. There may be some others out there, Lord God, suffering with COVID-19, God. Heal the bodies, Lord God. We lift up, Lord God, Bishop Peace, Lord God, and Shirley Merrill, Lord God, and Jenny Wilson, Lord God, and Lord God, others, Lord God, are suffering with cancer, Lord God. We ask you to heal the body. Arrest that cancer right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Dry it up, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Kill every cancer cell right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Kill every COVID virus right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, God. You are a healer, Lord God. And Lord God, we just plead the blood of Jesus over them right now, God. Lay your healing hands on their bodies right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. And continue to heal, Lord God. Anthony Sumner, Lord God. Continue to heal, Lord God. Sherry Whitfield Jones, Lord God. Sherelle, rather. Continue to heal right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Heal, deliver, set your people free, God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Build up the immune system, Lord God. Some suffering with COPD, Lord God. Asthma, Lord God. Heal the immune system, Lord God, right now. They're able to fight off these viruses, fight off these germs right now in the name of Jesus, God. Heal, Lord God, of diabetes, Lord God. Heal the mother cirrhosis, Lord God. Heal, Lord God, high blood pressure, high cholesterol. Heal right now. Dementia, Alzheimer's, Lord God. Heal right now. Back pain. pains, Lord God. Arthritis, heal right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Hallelujah, heal right now, God. We lift up Malik Davis and BJ Bailey, Lord God. Lift up Donovan Plummer, Lord God. Tina Williams, Lord God. Lift them up unto you, Lord God. Our children to you, Lord God. Lift them up, grandchildren. Lift them up unto you, Lord God. Some are struggling, Lord God, in the walk, Lord God, with you. Some are struggling, Lord God, financially, Lord. Some are struggling, Lord God, to find themselves, Lord God. But Lord God, let them find you, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. We lift them up for protection. All the college students, lift them up, Lord God. Protect them, Lord God. Call on your name for Augustine Manga, Lord God. Lift her up, Lord God. Take the stress from her, Lord God. Stress, Lord God, a life, Lord God, of wearing our people down, Lord God. Remove stress, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. Tension, Lord God. These things, Lord God, bring upon, Lord God, other health issues, Lord God. So, Lord God, take the stress from them, Lord. Give them peace, Lord God, in the mind, Lord God. Lord God, we just pray right now, Lord God, for Dally Dixon, Lord God, that's in GW Hospital, Lord God. Heal her body, Lord God. Lay your hands on her, Lord God. Lord God, break up, Lord God, those blood clots right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. Dissolve them right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, heal her body, God. Hallelujah, and Lord God. Lord God, heal over the stroke, Lord God. Heal her right now in the name of Jesus. Restore functionality to her body. Restore functionality to her mind right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. We lift up, Lord God, those looking for houses, Lord God. Those who are unemployed, Lord God. Those, Lord God, seeking something for you. Lift them up unto you, Lord God. Lift them up, Lord God. Be a way maker for them right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Lift up pastor to you, Lord God. Hallelujah, God. We know it's not easy to be a pastor, Lord God. We lift them up unto you, Lord God. So many people pulling here and there, Lord God. Lift up pastors, Lord God. Cover them with your blood, Lord God. In the name of, give them boldness. Give them wisdom. Give them revelation, Lord God. Whatever they need, God. Keep them in your word, Lord God. Keep them on their knees praying, Lord God. Lord God, keep them loving the saints, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, Lord God. Lift them up, Lord God. Those who are working, Lord God, in those areas, Lord God, in medical fields, Lord God, in grocery stores, Lord God, that are always out there, Lord God, on the front line, Lord God. We plead the blood of Jesus over them right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. We lift up these businesses, Lord God, the hair salons, the nail salons, Lord God, these small businesses, Lord God. Lord God, we ask you to keep them, Lord God, in the midst of this pandemic, Lord God. Keep them, Lord God. Keep the finance. Keep the customers, Lord God. Lord God, restore, Lord God, everything that this disease has taken, Lord God. Restore right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Lord God, we just know right now, Lord God. Lord God, this thing is coming to an end, Lord God. Don't know when, Lord God. But Lord God, there should be glory after this disease, Lord God. So we pray, Lord God, that more people will come to you even right now, Lord God, during this pandemic, Lord God. Do a shaking in this earth, Lord God. A stirring in this earth right now in the name. Begin to draw people to you, Lord God. Draw them, Lord God, from the east and the west and north and the south. Draw them unto you, Lord God. Lord God, let them lift up their names right in their hands right now, Lord God. And Lord God, call on your name, Lord God, and be saved right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. We thank you for that, Lord God. We pray for the bereaved, all bereaved, Lord God. There are so many still bereaved, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Pray for them. Comfort, Lord God. Comfort, comfort, comfort. Comfort, Lord God, in the name of Jesus. We pray for little babies, Lord God, that's born into this world, Lord God. Lord God, we pray for them, Lord God. Protect them, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, for this normalcy, Lord God. We pray for this upcoming elections, Lord God. Lord God, we pray that your people who call by your name will humble themselves, Lord God. Turn from their wicked ways, Lord God. Seek you. Hunger and thirst for you, Lord God. And then, Lord God, you will forgive their sin. Heal the land, Lord God. But, Lord God, we need to hunger and thirst for you, Lord God. We need to put you back on the throne, Lord God. We need to, Lord God, begin to call on you, Lord God. Because, Lord God, you will cure us when we call on your name, God. We love you, God. We love you, Lord God. Lord God, lift up Pastor Steve Tillett, Lord God. And, Lord God, death in the family, Lord God. Comfort that family, Lord God. Call your name for the Hawkins family, the Bullock family, the Broder family, Lord God. Comfort that family, Lord God. Those families, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. There might be others, Lord God, suffering bereavement, Lord God. We call on your name. We stand in the gap, Lord God. We stand as intercessors even right now, God. We intercede on the behalf of others, Lord God. In the name of Jesus, Lord God. Lift up countenance right now, Lord God. Lift up bowed down heads, Lord God. Let them look into the hills, Lord God. God, from which comes the help. Give them hope, Lord God. Let hope run in their veins right now, Lord God. Remove that despair from them, Lord God. Remove hopelessness, Lord God. Fill their veins, Lord God, the heart with hope, Lord God. Hope yet in the Lord, Lord God. Don't let them be downcast, Lord God, but let them have hope, Lord God, that they can lift up their heads, Lord God. Hallelujah. And call on you, Lord God, who will answer them by and by, Lord God. Hope, Lord God. Stir up your hope, Lord God. Hope, Lord God. Remove despair, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. This is not a time to despair and be hopeless, Lord God, because our God still reigns. He still reigns. So we thank you, you're still reigning today, Lord God. Not physical rain, but you're raining down your glory on your people, peace on your people. Rain down on me right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Oh, Lord God, break up fallow ground, Lord God. Soften hard hearts, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. Let love, Lord God, come from the people, Lord God, right now in the name of Jesus, Lord God. And we bless, Lord God, the fivefold ministry, Lord God. We thank you for apostles and prophets, Lord God. We thank you for evangelists and pastors and teachers, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for them edifying the body of Christ, Lord God, even during this pandemic, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for the word that was spoken today, Lord God. We pray, Lord God, that we grab hold of this word, hide it in our hearts, Lord God, that we might not sin. Hide in our hearts, Lord God, that we can remember how good you are, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God. We praise your name. We pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 To God be the glory. Thank you, God. Thank you, family. Thank you, friends. Thank you for tuning in. Thank you. Amen. Have a blessed day in the Lord. Be blessed, be blessed, be blessed. I decree and declare, amen, that this is going to be a good day for you. But you have to choose it to be a good day. Amen. You have to choose. Amen. Amen. You can dictate how your day is going to be. No matter what happens, you can choose to have a good day. Just like God said in his word, this is the day that he has made. We have to choose to rejoice in it. We have to choose to be glad in it. So do make better choices about your relationship with the Lord. Make better choices. Amen. Amen. Choose, amen, to have a good day. God bless you. Love you all. Okay, goodbye, good night, good evening. Oh, have a good day. So, yeah, so have a good night later on, good evening later on, but just to be blessed and have a good